As you do sit down, grab your Bible, a pen, your notes. Get ready to write a few things down this morning. I'm not going to keep you very long. Maybe. We will see. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for our hope that is found in you. That we are a people who don't have to grieve as people with no hope. No, Father, we have something to see, something to look forward to. Help us here today to catch a vision for what is to come, for what you have in store for us. Help us to look forward to that day, to rejoice in that day. Help us, Father, to live in such a way that we will bring as many people as we can, friends and family, people we know, into that saving knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ, so that they too will be there when we meet you. We love you and we praise you. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yes, this time, just about every year, my dad would say, time to go on vacation. Summer vacation for us, well, it usually involved heading south. Why? My father loved the beach, and we usually would go drive down I-75 looking for a beach somewhere where we could sit there and look at the ocean. Maybe every once in a while it was Disney World, but most often it was a beach. In order to get there, though, we had to prepare the car. We had to pack it up. And so we would do just that. The day would come. We'd pack our suitcases, and we'd go put them in our car. Now, our car at the time, let me just tell you, was it was Motor Trend's car of the year. Yes, we were riding in style in those days. To describe the car, some of you might have memory of such a car as this, but the car that we drove to Florida was a baby blue AMC Pacer station wagon. Yes, the one with all the windows, you might remember. And we being my mother and my father, and my two sisters, would pile in that car after putting all the luggage in the back. Of course, my youngest sister had to sit in the middle of me and my sister in that back seat all the way down. Now, let me just say, back in those days, we kids, we had no games to play. No video games, no entertainment centers, no earbuds to put in our ears, no iPods or iPads, no social media that we could connect to. No, it was very different in those days. In those days, my mom made up games to keep us from being bored. Some of you might remember the game where you looked for Volkswagen Beetles. Yeah, that didn't last long. We were bored again. Oh, my goodness, those were some long drives, and inevitably, somewhere along the way, the fighting would break out. It would begin, "Get off me! Mom, she's touching me." And Dad threatening, don't make me pull this car over. But then somewhere along the way, one of us would yell out, "Are we there yet?" 10 minutes later, somebody else would yell out, "Are we there yet?" And all the way down, we'd be asking, "Are we there yet?" The reason I tell you that today is, in many ways, that's the question that rolls in our mind. Are we there yet? Are we almost to that place? That destination. You see, life really is so much really just a journey, only to end up in a destination where we spend eternity. The moments here on this ride, well, they might seem long and hard and difficult at times, but they're going to go by fast. And then the end comes. The end, who knows when it is? Are we there yet? I don't know. I don't know my end, your end. Are you there yet? Maybe. Am I there yet? Maybe. Or maybe there's many more years to come. Are we there yet? I don't know. Sometimes it almost seemed easier if we could kind of find an expiration date stamped on ourselves. so that we could be ready, we could be prepared. But no. Now, for some, it sneaks up. For some, it comes quick. For some, we're not expecting it. For some, we might really just not be so very ready. And for that reason, there's a lot of fear that surrounds death. There's a lot of nervousness. There's a lot of worry. There's a lot of doubt. But you know, it's interesting in Scripture because we are told as children of God that we don't have to weep as those who weep who have no hope. That we can see this differently, we can think differently as we look to the Word of God. That final destination is something that we can be looking forward to. We can rejoice in because of the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. I want to talk about that this morning with you today for just the next few minutes and why it is that you and I, we don't have to be fearful of death that is to come. That we, in fact, can see it in a completely different way. Several things you'll write down this morning, five to be specific, but I'm going to begin in John chapter 14, starting in verses 1 through 2, to give you a little bit of preface to that, though, so you understand the context in which Jesus is speaking here. It's the night of the Passover. It's the Last Supper that maybe you've read about or heard about, where Jesus is with his disciples in an upper room, and there's a meal that has been prepared before them. At one point, Jesus takes this bread, and it says that he chooses the bread, he blesses the bread, he breaks the bread, and then he gives the bread. And as he does this, he says, let this represent, remember this is my body which is broken for you. In other words, this is about to happen. My body is going to be broken. I'm going to be killed. And then he takes the cup and he says, let this represent the wine. This is my blood, or let this wine represent my blood. This is the blood that is spilled for you. In other words, I'm about to die and I'm dying for you. Well, you can imagine these disciples who have been with him so long, they get a little upset, they get a little mad, a little angry, a little frustrated, a little worried. They're saying, what are you talking about? How dare you say that? You can't do that to us. And this is where he begins to comfort him. And he says, hey, guys, don't worry. Calm down. And here's why. Verse 1, don't let your hearts be troubled, Jesus says. Trust in God. Trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. Do you see where he immediately goes? He immediately goes and says, there is this place. Don't worry, there is this place. What you see here is not all there is. There is a home, and it's my Father's home, and there's plenty of room for you. That's going to be your place too. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? What does he mean by all this? And what can we expect as those who have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ? Several things to write down this morning. The first one is simply this. Number one, heaven is home. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you in my Father's home. Here, Revelation 21, verse 3. It says, look, God's home is now among his people. That's God's home, and he's saying God's home is going to be your home. In fact, God's home is your home. Jesus goes on to tell the disciples that when you are in me, I am with the Father is one with me, and that makes you and the Father one, even as we are one. He's saying it's all right here together, and you make your home is heaven, and it's waiting for you. Home. If you were to describe home, what words might you use? Home. For me, I wrote down where I belong. Home is that place where I know that I belong, where I know that this is it for me. This is where I fit. It's kind of hard for me to describe this, but let me try. My home, I want you guys to know that at my home, I do things at my home that I probably would not do in here. Anybody like that? Huh? Yeah? Yeah, you do some things. How about this? My favorite shirts to wear in my home, my wife will tell you this. My kids will tell you this. They have holes all in them. And Kim every once in a while says, can I throw that away? No, don't throw that away. It's my shirt. I like my shirt. Now, here's the thing. I'm not going to get up here on Sunday wearing my favorite shirt, my favorite home shirt, right? That's my home shirt. This is a church shirt right here, okay? I mean, it's my church shirt. I don't wear this around the house. I don't do that. Mainly because, you know, it's kind of nice. Had to get ironed and all that stuff. No, man, my home shirt's got holes all in it, and it feels good. How about this? There are noises I make at my home that I wouldn't make here. Anybody? Oh, don't act like you don't do that. Yeah, there are some noises. One of them is this time of year and on into spring and everything. And I don't know, any of you have allergies? You ever get allergies and get that drainage stuff going on and you just kind of feel it right there? And you know, in my home, I walk around and go, and my family's used to it, you know? Yeah, it's gross, right? I wouldn't do that here. Well, I just did, but that's a home thing, right? But it's because I fit there. It's because I belong there. It's because I know that I can do stuff there that I'll still be loved even if I do it. Because they know me, right? I want you to understand something. A day is coming where you are going back to the place from whence you first came. Do you guys know, according to Scripture, that God thought of you? God created you. David said, knitted you together in the womb. You're God's idea. And you are one day going back to the very one who knows everything about you. All the noises you make, all the holes in your life, all the stuff that you might have tried for so long to hide from everybody else out here, but you're going back to that place where he knows you inside and out, every little detail of your life. And you know what? He loves you. He loves you. That's home. That's home. That place that in a weird sort of way, so many of us are deep down still longing for. We wander this world and we find ourselves lonely day in and day out. And that loneliness, if we could search it, we could find out it goes back to this longing to be one with God, our home, in our home. Revelation 21:3 again. Look, God is now among his people. In other words, you're one of them, one of his. And this is your home to be with him. You ever get homesick? I tell you guys, I've had the privilege of going to so many places around this world, places that you're going, wow, that's one of the great wonders of the world, one of those, and you see amazing things, and it's so cool. But in all those places, when I go and I travel and I see some amazing things, there's one place that I always want to get back to. There's one place that means more than any of the other places, and that's home. That's home. Why is that? It's because I fit. I belong there. It's from where I came. I was in London just January. And in London, you know, everybody talks funny, right? But it's funny because I'm there and I'm speaking to a group of people. And I can notice as I say certain things that I all start snickering, laughing. You know what they're laughing at? My accent, right? My southern accent. But you know what? You guys don't laugh at my southern accent. Why? Because you got the same one. You got the same one going on. It all sounds fine to you, doesn't it? Yeah, I say, yeah, ain't nothing wrong with that. You know what else over there? They actually told me, they said, oh, my goodness, there's this one thing we cannot stand to eat that you guys love to eat. And I said, what is that? And they said, grits. I said, what is wrong with you people, man? Don't tell me you don't like grits. I was getting offended by that. Why? Because that's home, man. That's where I grew up. That's home. That's where I came from. That's where I belong. That's those who know me and the people who get me in the same way. You're going to the place to the one who knows you the best, the one who gets you, the one who loves you. Home. Heaven is home. Number two, heaven is a reunion. A reunion. And boy, is that ever some good news. I was watching as Carmen was singing that song a second ago, and I was watching so many of your faces, and I could just see on your faces that thought of, yeah, one day to be able to see some of those same people again, those people who have gone on before me, to be reunited. It says right here, look what it says, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4:13. Now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to all the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. Isn't that good news? Yeah, our farewells here are not forever. That we will be reunited with those that we love, those who have gone on before us. I know I'm a little bit weird and a little bit strange in some of the ways I think, but you know what I picture? I picture happening. How many of you have ever been to the Atlanta airport or flown in to the Atlanta airport? Yeah, yeah. You know how it goes, right? They pull up to the gate in your plane, you get out and you go at whatever gate it is, and concourse, you walk down the concourse, and then you go down the escalators, and you get down to where the trains are, right? You follow me? And you hop on the train, and it zips you from one concourse to the next until finally it says baggage claim, right? And you get off at baggage claim, you and all these people, you get off the train, and you go, and you go to those escalators, like the longest escalators in the world, right? You know, with me? And you get on that escalator, and you know what's about to happen, right? You're going to the top of that escalator really, really slowly. And just as you get to the top of that escalator, what do you see? There, you come up, and it's all roped off, and you see a line of people, right? You see a line of people, and all those people are doing this. And some have flowers, some have signs, right? Right? And there you are, and you top that elevator, and you're doing this too. Yeah? Huh? And then you see it happen, that this person sees that person, and finally faces light up. And I remember doing that as well, looking for Kim. And I see Kim, and I see the kids, and you go and you embrace. I know I'm weird, but I kind of think that might be like escalators and all. You know? And boom, you're there, and then you see those who have gone on before you. That loved one, it might have been that spouse, might have been that child, that grandparent, that friend. Heaven is a reunion. And that's why he says you don't have to grieve as so many people who grieve who don't have that hope, because you guys, you have that hope that can only come through Jesus Christ, that this is not all there is, that there's more. When I hear the reunion, it makes me think of another use of that word reunion, not just to come together people like that, but it was July 4th every year when I was a kid growing up that we had our family reunion. It was always in the North Georgia mountains where my father's side of the family came from. And we would drive up there every July 4th. And I remember we'd get out and there'd be a ton of people at this family reunion. All these people I had no idea were family, right? Didn't even know them, didn't seem like them, never saw them maybe once a year, but they were family. And in a weird sort of way, I think so many of us it's gonna be like that kind of reunion, because we're gonna get, by the way, if you ever start thinking a little too much of yourself, if you ever get a little bit, if you ever need a little bit of humbling, go to your family reunion, okay? you know what I mean? You're gonna get there and you'll be like, this is the same blood? This is where I came from? Right? Anybody with me on that? Yeah. Some of you wives are like, that's my husband's family for sure, man. Oh my goodness, that is my husband's family for sure. But here's the deal. Get this, okay? Be careful, because he didn't choose it, but you married him. You chose into that, okay? So what does that say about you? Anyway. But you go to a family. I think heaven very well could possibly be. When we get to heaven, what are we going to do? We're going to look around and going to be like, what are you doing here? You really? Why is that? You know why that is? Because for so many of us, our mindset regarding heaven has been, well, good people go to heaven, bad people go to hell. People who deserve it, really deserve it, they're the ones in heaven. We're going to look around and we're going to be surprised. Billy Graham was asked, who are the people that are going to go to heaven? And Billy Graham said, I think when we all get to heaven, we're going to be surprised who's there. We're going to be very surprised at who's there. What am I trying to say? There's that song. You know the song, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I want you to look around at all the wretches around you. Look, say the person next to you, you are such a wretch. But do you understand what I'm saying? Heaven is going to be filled with wretches. Heaven's going to be filled with wretches. Why? Because not one of us, by anything that we could do, ever could earn our way to heaven. Every single one of us is a wretch. But the good news, when you realize that you're a wretch, you have to rely on the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ alone. And it's only by His grace that any one of us will be in heaven. So it's going to be one big reunion of wretches because of God's grace. Heaven is a reunion. Number three, heaven is everything made right. Yeah, just write it down that way. I'll explain to you what I'm talking about. Heaven is everything made right. When you were a kid, I know what you said. You used to say it. Something wouldn't go your way, and you would say, "That's not fair." And your parents would say back to you, my dad would always say, "Life's not fair." And he'd add a little something to it. "And then you die." And he'd laugh. "Take that, kid." Oh, it used to make me so mad. Because it's supposed to be fair. Isn't it supposed to be? Come on. Life's not fair. Now in this broken and fallen world, because of our sin, now there's no fairness. There's no fairness. And we might yell for fairness. We might demand fairness. We might pout for fairness, but it's a broken, sinful world. There's something wasn't going quite the way I thought it should go yesterday. I'm just kind of pouting around the house a little bit here. Any of you ever pout like that a little bit? Yeah, I can't believe it, man. My life is so tough. Can't believe it happens to me like that. We do that, don't we? And I think so. It's so interesting. God, if you let Him, can be so faithful. And you think you have it bad? You think you have it bad? And it began to remind me of this time last year. Kim and I are going down some dirt roads in a van on the way to meet some little children who pretty much don't have shoes to wear. 11 brothers and sisters in a house 10 by 10. Barely enough food to eat, if that. Or I'm reminded of driving through these big heaps of garbage, this trash through Nicaragua, and seeing these little kids come out of this garbage after they've been searching, hoping to find something to eat. And I'm going, life's not fair. But you see, one day, everything will be made right. Everything will be made right. It says right here, let me read it to you, Revelation 21:4. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. Who would vote for that, huh? And that's where it's going to. That's where we're heading. You might look around and see all the mess and the filth and terrible things going on in this world and say, God, why don't you do something? How could God let this happen? But exactly, that is exactly what he has done. He sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross to pay for our sin, the sin that broke this world, the sin that caused this mess, to take it all on himself, offering us grace and forgiveness, eternity in heaven, where, yes, God sits on what is called the mercy seat, where he judges rightly. And one day, every tear is wiped away. Everything is made right. Revelation 22, verse 3 says, no longer will there be a curse on anything. Heaven is everything made right. Number 4, heaven is a celebration. A celebration, as you write celebration, you might also write the word out next to it, worship. Worship. What is worship? Worship is saying something is worthy of being praised. And that is heaven. That's what it describes right here, Revelation 22, verse 3. For the throne of God and the Lamb will be there, and his servants will worship him. What's it going to be like? How many of you have been watching the World Cup? Any of you? I think 2 people. Okay. Yeah, that's good. 2. Yeah, 2. Okay. For those of you who don't know what the World Cup is, it's a giant soccer match from countries all over the world. It's going on right now. And it's a pretty big deal, but evidently not here, okay? But I've been watching the World Cup. I kind of enjoy watching those games. It's really interesting because you see a country win in a particular game, and then they'll suddenly cut to that country, and there'll be huge parties of people gathered viewing the game, and they just start going absolutely berserk, absolutely nuts. Some of you might have read in the paper that when Mexico won their first game, that so many people celebrated at once that it actually registered on the Richter scale. It did, I'm telling you, as if an earthquake was going on. Isn't that amazing? And that's just Mexico, okay? So now I want you to kind of go with me here. So we think Mexico, and then if you've ever been to Brazil, the Brazilians, those guys can really celebrate, man, okay? I mean, they'll rock. In Brazil, when they win, they're going nuts. Now here, Brazil celebrates, Mexico celebrates, and then you have Portugal celebrating, and then you have Spain celebrating, and then you have Senegal celebrating. Now, here's what I'm talking about. All these people are going absolutely berserk and nuts celebrating because somebody kicked a ball into a net. I mean, really, that's what happened. Somebody kicked a ball in the net. And the reason I say that is, can you imagine? Can you just imagine with me for a moment on that day where it's going to be all of Mexico? The scripture says every tribe, every tongue, every nation. It's going to be Brazilians. It's going to be the Spaniards. It's going to be even the Russians. It's going to be even the Americans. It's going to be the Senegalese. It's going to be the Indians. It's going to be the Chinese. It's going to be every tribe, every tongue, every nation. And we're celebrating so much more. We are celebrating that the Lamb of God has conquered sin and death forever. That's not just going to shake one country. That's going to shake heaven and earth. When we worship him that way, it is going to be a party like no other. A celebration. A celebration. Heaven is a celebration. And finally, I want you to write this down. Number 5, heaven is the presence of God. Heaven is the presence of God. Him never living without you, you never living without him. Revelation 21:3, he will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. Jesus said, when everything's ready, I will come get you, so that you will always be with me where I am, and you know the way to where I'm going, he says. In other words, it's happening, I'm coming to get you, you always be with me. The presence of God, in the presence of Jesus, forever and ever. One of my favorite stories ever is about the Rogers family. And Father Rogers, he was always intent at teaching his kids about the things of God's Word, Scripture, and he would often at the dinner table, as soon as dinner was over, they'd have this time of devotions together with the family, and he would quiz each of his kids. And on this one particular day, he's quizzing his three kids, and he gets to his son, Jimmy, who's 7 years old, and says, Jimmy, tell me what you think it's going to be like and how you know that you're going to heaven when you die. And Jimmy, in his 7-year-old mind, begins to describe. He goes, well, I think it's going to be like this, that we're going to get there, and there's like going to be a big gate, and there's going to be this really big angel, and he's going to have just a really big book that has a lot of names in it, and he's going to start calling out names. And he's going to get to Daddy Rogers, Daddy, and he's going to call your name out, and you're going to go, here. And he's going to call out Mommy Rogers, and you'll go, here. And he's going to call out his big sister, Susie Rogers, and you'll say, here. And he's going to call out Mavis, and his brother, and he'll say, here. And then finally, he's going to call out my name, he said. And because I'm so small and I'll be behind a lot of people, I'm going to have to jump up and down and wave my arms and yell real loud. And I'm going to yell, here! Well, they all had a good laugh over that. Finished the cleaning up and went to bed that night. And it was just a few days later that Jimmy was running out to get on the bus for school and got hit by a car. The ambulance came quickly. They took him, rushed him to the hospital. He's unconscious, never to regain consciousness. Doctors called the family and pretty much said, listen, we've done everything that we can. There's no hope. In fact, he might not make it even through the night. The family stayed close to his bed that night, praying and touching and holding. It was late at night that suddenly his body began to shake a little bit. He got fidgety. They were hoping maybe something was changing, but that wouldn't be the case. Instead, can you imagine the peace and the comfort and the hope that was given when all that happened was they heard Jimmy say one word, clear enough for everybody to hear. He said, here. Are we there yet? I don't know. But I do know one day, if you've put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, one day you'll say, finally, here, and you'll be at your destination. Let's bow in a word of prayer. Do you have that confidence, the confidence that Jimmy had? Have you asked Jesus into your heart for the forgiveness of your sins? Knowing that nothing you can do, your own power, your own strength, no good thing you could do, no trying to fix that, nothing you could do could get you to heaven, but it's simply putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and what he has already done for you. If you never asked Jesus into your heart for the forgiveness of your sins, friends, will you do that right now, please, right here, right now. Quietly in your own mind, talk to him, call out to him. Jesus hears you. He knows your thoughts. Say, Jesus, today, I ask you to come into my heart and forgive me of my sin. I believe that you died on the cross for me. And I want to live in heaven with you forever. And then say, thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. The Bible says you pray that prayer, you mean it with your heart, you can know for sure you're going to heaven when you die. And listen, if you prayed that this morning, please tell somebody. Don't make them guess. Don't make them wonder. Tell the person next to you. Tell your friend that you've made that decision. Tell your family, please. Share with somebody so they know. So they know. And can rejoice in that same hope. Father, I thank you so much for those who prayed that prayer and made that decision today. I thank you for the joy that you give us, the hope that you give us, that we do not weep as those would weep who have no hope. Thank you for your son, Jesus, and the gift of eternal life that he has given. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.